Success! The AI beat me! Hello world, it's Siraj, and just a few days ago, OpenAI's team of bots won a match against a team of some of the best Dota players in the world. I'll explain how they did it in this video, and if you're new here, hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on my latest AI content. The event was streamed online to over 100,000 people, and it was massive. I was there in the thick of it, amongst the crowd, and could feel the energy all around me. I even got to say hi to Andre Karpathy, which was algorithmic. Yes, I'm starting that. This is a big deal. The entire AI community is very excited about the results. OpenAI calls their algorithm 5 because it's a set of 5 neural networks that work together to defeat the opposing team. OpenAI 5 has now played against several opposing teams. Although it started off playing against OpenAI employees, it moved on to audience members, Valve employees, an amateur team, a semi-pro team, and now this. The reason OpenAI is dedicating all of their time and energy to creating bots that can beat humans at games is because the idea that if an AI can learn how to navigate and strategize in an unstructured, messy, unpredictable environment like a game world, we can transfer all of those skills that it's learned onto complex, real-world problems like drug discovery, materials design, climate change, and ASMR videos. When IBM's Deep Blue beat the world champion Garry Kasparov at chess in the 90s, it surprised a lot of people. And the algorithms it used, including tree search, minimax, and alpha beta pruning, proved to be useful in other applications like route planning for vehicles. Just last year, a similar victory occurred when Google's AlphaGo bot beat the best Go player in the world. Go has a search space that's orders of magnitude larger than chess, and many wrongly predicted that it wouldn't be possible for an AI to defeat a human so soon. Now, with OpenAI 5, Dota, or Defense of the Ancients 2, is the newest game to be conquered. Dota 2 is an online multiplayer game where two teams consisting of 5 players each compete to collectively destroy a large structure defended by the opposing team called the Ancient, while defending their own. It's a real-time strategy game, and it's presented on a single map from a 3-dimensional perspective. The game has 115 playable characters that players can choose from. Each has its own design, strength, and weaknesses. Once a game begins, players start off with an experience level of 1 with just one ability, but are able to level up and become more powerful during the course of the game, up to a maximum level of 25. Abilities are gradually unlocked. In 2011, the creators of Dota, Valve, sponsored 16 teams to compete at the International, a Dota-specific sports tournament for a $1 million prize. Since then, it's become an annual championship tournament with the prize money increasing each year. In total, Dota 2 tournaments have earned teams over $100 million in prize money up to now, making it the highest earning esports game of all time. BRB, switching careers. Players dedicate real time and effort to become professionals at this game, which makes OpenAI's win that much more impressive. OpenAI 5 consists of 5 neural networks. Each neural network is a single layer, 1024 unit, long short-term memory recurrent network. Recurrent networks specialize in sequence learning. Give it a sequence of words and it'll predict the next word in that sequence, unless the input data is too big. If there are too many words, the recurrent network will start to forget what it learned from the first words. A variant of recurrent networks, LSTM networks, account for this problem. Popularly known as the vanishing gradient problem, by adding a clever combination of operations and variables to the network, such that during the gradient descent process, where the gradient value is what we use to update the weights of the network accordingly during every training iteration, doesn't vanish. It's maintained throughout the network. It's locked into the weights of the LSTM network components called gates accordingly. And since the gates are differentiable, the cell learns what's important to remember and what's important to forget over time during optimization. Each OpenAI single layer LSTM network receives the current Dota 2 game state as its input, which is extracted from Valve's bot API. This contains all the relevant data about where players are and what's happening on the map inside of a vector. The output of each LSTM is an action on what to do next. There are several possible action heads, and the LSTM chooses the specific action path to take, then executes it. In a supervised learning scenario, it's all about learning the input data slash label relationship so that given new data, it can label it properly. But unfortunately, there's no static data set here. Sorry, Kaggle. It's a real-time environment, and the signal is not an immediate label, but instead a time-delayed label called a reward. This is instead a paradigm called reinforcement learning. The reward is provided by the environment itself and specified by the creator of the environment. OpenAI developed a reward that consisted of a combination of aggregated metrics, including net worth, kills, and assists. These rewards can either be positive or negative, depending on what the agent does in the environment. The agent receives the state of the game as input, takes an action in the environment, and either receives a positive or negative reward signal, which it uses to update its weights to select an action more likely to receive a reward every training iteration. The agent in this case is an LSTM neural network, and we can frame the way it has to make decisions as what's called a Markov decision process. There's a set of possible game states, of possible actions, a reward function, and a description of each action's effects in each state. The reason it's called Markov is because it'll have the Markov property, which states that the effects of an action taken in a given state depend only on that state and not on the prior history. Although the dynamics of the environment are outside of the agent's control, it will, through the training process, develop what's called a policy. A policy is defined as the probability distribution of actions given a state. It can use this policy to decide what the next best action to take would be. The objective of any reinforcement learning agent is to maximize the expected reward when following a policy. To learn this policy, lots of algorithms exist. One popular algorithm is called policy gradients. The idea is that when an agent takes an action in an environment, it might receive a positive reward. But what if that action is actually bad in the long run? What if we could wait and see how this action played out until someone wins the game? The PG algorithm helps learn a policy that samples actions, and then the actions that happen to eventually lead to good outcomes get encouraged in the future. The actions taken that lead to bad outcomes get discouraged. Seems legit. Each action has an advantage estimate. It numerically answers the question of how much better is this action than the average or expected action I'd take at this state. The gradients that are computed during optimization are accumulated over a number of full played episodes, then applied to the network. But it turns out there's a problem with policy gradient methods. They're very sensitive to the choice of step size during the training process. If a step is too small, then the progress is small. And if it's too large, the response will be noisy, making it very challenging. In a policy gradient setting, if the agent ends up in a poor region of action space, it can leave it in a position where it has very few useful state action pairs to learn from. For example, if an agent tries to navigate a maze to find some cheese and had accidentally learnt a policy of just spinning in circles, it would have a hard time reaching any actions that had a positive reward, since it could only learn to increase an action probability by experiencing that action and seeing that it leads forward. It literally gets stuck in its own learned loop with no way out. How can we make an update that's guaranteed to improve our current policy, or at least not make it worse? God mode, of course, just kidding. Well, if we separate our policy into two policies, a post-update policy called the new policy, and a pre-update policy called the old policy, we can calculate this. At each state, we take a sum over the actions of the new policy probability at that state, multiplied by how much better that action is than the average old policy action at that state, termed the advantage. We then weigh each state's expected new policy advantage by how likely that state is to be reached by the new policy. This gets us the expected advantage of the new policy over the old one and lets us confirm that expected advantage is positive before we take a move. The approach of the Trust Region Policy Optimization Algorithm, or TRPO, is to calculate an estimate of the advantage quantity we've just described, but doing so using the distribution of states from the old policy rather than the state distribution from the new policy. It controls the rate of policy change by placing a constraint on the average difference, or KL divergence, between the new and old policy after each update. Even still, TRPO has a very poor sample efficiency, usually taking a large number of training steps to optimize. OpenAI introduced their own spin-off of TRPO called Proximal Policy Optimization, and that's the algorithm they used for their bots. It simplifies the problem by converting TRPO's KL divergence from a constraint into a penalty term. With no need to compute the KL divergence, the algorithm is less complex. It strikes a balance between ease of implementation, sample complexity, and ease of tuning. So OpenAI trained 5 LSTM networks using PPO on 256 GPUs available on Google Cloud, playing 180 years worth of games against itself every day. From walking to skill development to learning coordination, their bots improved throughout the process. The next step for the team is to move on to the international and play against the best in the world. If you want to learn more about any of the topics I've talked about, check out the links in the video description. All your policy are belong to us. Hit subscribe if AI excites you too, and make sure to connect with me on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. For now, I've got to play with some data, so thanks for watching.